execute some Drush operations. Then we can do some automated functional or load or smoke testing. We can do anything else. I believe there are no limits. But we have only 20 minutes today, so, and I already spent 2 minutes. So I'm going to pick up one workflow only, and this will be Kubernetes, creating Kubernetes cluster, okay? So we're going to create Kubernetes cluster on Google Cloud, but in fact, the specific workflow is not important here, because I just want to share the tools, and this is just an example, so please pay attention to the tools, but not the exact specifics of Kubernetes or something like that, because that's not an important thing today. So when we talk about workflow, I imagine it is an evolution. So first of all, we have a very simple workflow, and then we kind of evolve to something better, better, and better, and in the end, we have like production-ready workflow. And usually, it takes some iterations to do that. So if you talk about creating Kubernetes cluster, our first option is to create it manually with Google Cloud user interface, so we can log in with our browser to Google Cloud, and then we can pick up some parameters like version of the cluster, like number of nodes, like type of these nodes, some other parameters, and then we hit create button and we are okay. In a couple of minutes our Kubernetes cluster is created, and yeah, we are done. We already have the Kubernetes cluster, it's working. Is it okay? Yes, but it still has some cons. So you can see these cons here. I'm not going to read it all, but congratulations, we just created our Snowflake cluster. Does anybody here knows what is Snowflake server? Snowflake server means that it's a manually created server. In our case, we manually created some cluster, some piece of infrastructure. And what is interesting about snowflakes? They are beautiful, right? Very beautiful, but they're different. And each time when we create some piece of infrastructure, for example, in our case, we create the cluster, it will be different each time. And it means it will be fragile. There is some cool guy, Martin Fowler, probably you know him, and he said smart words about fragility of snowflakes, and the main idea here that it's hard to change the snowflake server, it's hard to change the snowflake piece of infrastructure, because you created it manually, and probably in 1 year you don't remember why you put these settings here, or what was the reason of choosing this exact network settings or something like that, and you'll be in trouble. So we better avoid this snowflake, and we try to do it with the next iteration. And in the next iteration, we create the same cluster, but with some command, gcloud command from Google Cloud SDK software development kit. So we install this software development kit, and then we use command something like that. So we need to remember a lot of different parameters here. And again, in the end, we still have this Snowflake infrastructure. So we need to do something else, okay? So next iteration is much better. And the next iteration, we are going to use infrastructure is code principle, which means that we put everything into code. It means that we put all settings, all configuration, all logic into code, which means we can like check in this code into Git repo, so we will have all the good parts of Git, like history, logs, some permission system, and that's good, very good. And but we still have some cons, because for example, let's imagine the real life scenario. So we created the Kubernetes cluster, we use it, we put some applications, we deploy some applications into it, but at some point we want to upgrade it or change something, and I believe you know Murphy's law, if something can go wrong, it will go wrong. So yes, you can just hit the upgrade button, for example, and see what will happen, but that's kind of risky, because you don't know. probably it will break something. Probably some application will be not compatible with new version of Kubernetes. There is always some risk like that. So the better idea here is to create the test cluster to test this change before you move it into production. Okay? And in this case, you need to try to create this cluster, like exact copy of the production cluster, but at least the main parameters should be the same. Probably some not important parameters could be different, like number of nodes, stuff like that could be different, but main settings should be the same. So you need to create the same cluster with the same configuration files, but you can't do it with the same configuration files. You need to copy. So you need to copy paste configuration files into like different directory, and then you need to change some settings like name. So you created two copies of something. And in this case, you have a trouble because at some point you need to change something and you need to change it in two places. And you can forget to do that. And it will cause configuration drift. So it means that at some point your configurations could go like different ways and they will be different. And the whole scenario will take no sense because these clusters will be different. But okay, we have a solution for that, so we can try something like that. And the next iteration is to use some master configuration file and create specific environment specific configuration files like production and test automatically from the master configuration. Then we can apply it and create our production and test Kubernetes clusters. But to do it, we need to introduce some tools. So that's the main part about tools. But first, I want to talk about Unix philosophy a bit. This, you can see here, main principles of Unix philosophy. And the first one is do one thing and do it well, which means you should try to find the tools that do one thing and do it well. That tools should not try to do everything at once. They need like do something, but do it well. And then you combine these tools to work together, and you use plain text as interface of communication between these tools. So, and this conception works very well in our case, this workflows, CI/CD or DevOps workflows. So, first tool is Unicomf. I guess nobody knows about that because it's like in-house production, and sorry, no documentation here. But you can still read the source files if you need, but here I will explain how we use it. And this tool is used to process configuration files in YAML format. And here on left side we have input file and on the right side we have output file. As you can see, we define some configuration on the left side and it has common parameters for every cluster in our system, and then it has environment specific parameters. But on the right side, all parameters are combined into one list. So that's kind of the main purpose of this tool, to process the configuration files and extract the data that we need. Not extract, but collect. And here there is some explanation how it collects. So I believe that we don't have enough time to dig into that like in many details, so you can check it after, okay? The next tool is JQ. Anybody here knows JQ? Cool, because that's a very, very important tool, and if you work with JSON or YAML files, you really need to use this tool, because otherwise you're like wasting your time. And check the documentation. Documentation is very good, and a lot of scenarios, a lot of things here. So definitely one of the main tools in DevOps world, I believe. The other one is YQ. It's the same as JQ, but for YAML files. It basically is just a wrapper over JQ, okay? And here we can see how we combine these tools to work together. So the first one tool is processing and collecting our data, and then it pipes this like pipes pipe sign means that we use output of first command as input of the second command. So in the second command, we just extract some part of the YAML file here. So on the next slide, we can see the output. If you remember, it was configuration like that. And here we have output like plain values, configuration values. And then we use the next tool. The next tool named GomPlate. By any chance, anybody use it? No. Okay, check it out, because that's a very cool tool which is used to template rendering templates, and it supports local and remote data sources, and you can use a lot of things like Vault, console, JSON files, XML files, anything like that. So check the documentation, and here is the small example how we can use it. So we have these two commands are the same on the top, and then we added the GomPlate command, and we pipe the output of previous commands to as input to GomPlate. And here we can see the template for GomPlate. It has some placeholders, as you can see. It can have some functions. The tool itself is based on Golang, so it uses Go templates, and that's the name, GomPlate, Go template. So you can do a lot of things in template, and then you generate any kind of text configuration file here, okay? And here we generated the configuration file for Terraform. And Terraform is used to create our cluster as infrastructure as code principle. Okay. So the next tool is very important, because we talked about how we can avoid vendor lock-in. And this is most important tool to do that, because this tool is used like a glue to glue all the different commands in our workflow, in our pipeline, and we use it like probably some of you are using the makefile to combine some different commands into chains. And this is like makefile on steroids. And it allows us to put like chain of commands into one place and then execute it. And then we can execute this variant command from any CI/CD engine like Jenkins or Gitlab CI or Drone, you can name it, or from local. And this means that we invested like on open source tools, and we didn't invest on Jenkins or GitLab, and we can switch the engines easily, because our workflow is defined outside of these engines. And this tool allows us to do it in a convenient way. It allows us to define some parameters. It allows us to include something. It has a lot of things, so check the documentation, please. And you can see on the left side the task definition for variant, and on the right side example execution. So as you can see, we execute like environment, we pass the environment variable, and here on the left side we can see that environment variable is defined there, and I believe there is some error here, because the name should be the same. So I change the name. Environment should be environment, not env. Okay? But the meaning is the same. So we have this command executed, and then we have these commands, like we defined, but they are executed automatically for you. That's an example, like in big font, of using this tool. Okay, and you can see that's much more convenient to use the variant command instead of trying to remember all the parameters for other tools. Okay, so now we need to like support a lot of tools, and it creates for us some issue called dependency hell. So for some tools, probably we need some Python or Ruby or Node.js, and then versions could be different. And if we want to execute this workflow on some other place, we need to install all these tools, and it's not okay. But of course, solution here is containers. So we can put everything into container and execute it from container. So it solves the issue of dependency hell. And other thing is secrets management. If you want to avoid vendor locking, we need to find a way to provide our workflow with secrets, which means some passwords, some keys to access data. In our case, we need to access Google Cloud Console. So we need to have the Google cloud key file, secret key file on our like on local PC. Okay. So we used this tool for this example. We put every secret into Git repo, but encrypted it with Git secret. So check it out. And then we use encrypt it. We need the GPG key, and we store the GPG key in AWS parameter store. And to access it, we need like AWS credentials, and we store it in with AWS Vault tool locally, or in an encrypted way. If you need more details about that, please contact me. I'll show you a scenario how we use it, because 20 minutes is not enough to talk about that. So now we can execute this workflow locally, but also we can execute it on GitHub. And we have just a simple job here defined with some execution of commands, and we only need to pass the Amazon profile parameters like KID and access key, and it will be working. So demo time, I believe we have 1 or 2 minutes, so I'll try to show you like a real life example. And it's more complicated, it has more commands than I showed you, but the principle is the same. So we execute this GitLab job that I showed you, just showed you, and in the end, it's very slow. In the end, it executed all these programs. It processes configuration, execute some secret key decryption, stuff like that, and then it executes the Terraform command, Terraform initialization, and then executes Terraform. In our case, Terraform plan command, and it says that some parts of cluster should be changed, and we executed it very easily in GitLab. We can very easily execute in Jenkins as well, and the same for any other CI/CD engine. And also we can execute it on our local PC, and every time it will be the same. We just need to provide the access credentials to this workflow to be able to connect for all the APIs or for all other parties. Okay, so basically I believe that's all, and it's very slow. I'll try to go back to slides. It seems it's not working. Okay, guys, folks, sorry, but seems that I can't switch to slides back. So thank you very much. If you have any questions, please, I'll be here, and you can contact me by my name on Slack, Drupal Slack, and I'll be here to try to give you my email at least. And here, I don't know, I can't switch back to, it switched back. So these are contacts. Please find me on Drupal Slack and ask any questions, because now there is no time to do that. Thank you.